Thank you, everybody, for joining us. My name is David Tay. I am the curator of the exhibition in the second exhibition space, Misfits. I've also had the great pleasure of sort of co-organizing this series of discourse programs in conjunction with the two exhibitions, Misfits and the Tigers Show. It falls to me to introduce this afternoon's session. I will start by just very briefly introducing both of the speakers so that we can have the two presentations consecutively. The first speaker is Hongku Han, who teaches in the Department of Liberal Arts in Sung Kong Hall University in Seoul, South Korea. He's a graduate of the Department of National History at Seoul National University and obtained his PhD from Washington, at the University of Washington in the United States. He's one of the most prominent activist scholars in South Korea today and a popular interpreter of South Korean history to a wide audience. Through numerous books, including his four-volume History of South Korea and The Judiciary, The History of Those Under the Rule of Law, he has explored the violent and traumatic aspects of life under military dictatorship, interrogating their causes and bringing the victims' stories to light. I understand he's also been a participant in the National Truth and Reconciliation process in the 2000s. Park Chan-kyong is probably known to most of you. He's an artist and filmmaker based in Seoul. Both his fine art and film works primarily focus on the Cold War and the division of Korea. Since 2008, he's created photographs, video, and film works discussing Korea's native religion and shamanism. Recently, his work's been shown in solo exhibitions at Tina Kim Gallery in New York City, Innova in London. Former exhibitions include Shindoan at the Atelier Hermes in Seoul and Red Cat in Los Angeles. In 2014, he was also artistic director for the 8th SEMA Biennale Media City Seoul. His works have been exhibited at international venues such as the Taipei Biennale, the National Museum of Modern and Contemporary Art in Gwacheon, Korea, as well as the exhibition Animism in Seoul and the Korean Film Festival in Washington, D.C. I would also like to welcome Christina Yun Arnoldi, who will be our interpreter for the session for the Q&A afterwards. She'll do consecutive translations. Hongku, thank you.
Hi, everybody. I'm very much honored to be here. Before I start my main lecture, I'd like to show some images of Tiger, even though yesterday Yong had a wonderful presentation. This is the Japanese man, Yamamoto, and he had a hunting trip and published a book about conquering tigers. And this is the building is the Japanese Imperial Hotel, and he held in 1970 he held a banquet to taste the Korean tiger's meat, and the tiger was stopped and exhibited at the Japanese high school now. And let me see. Recently, there was a film. It was a full of nationalist appeal about the Korean tigers story, which was killed by Japanese military. And yesterday, he showed this map, and Im Hong-sun actually brought this map to this exhibition. But Chun Nam-sun drew this map in response to Japanese scholars drawing Korea as a rabbit. So no, Korea is not a rabbit. Korea is a tiger. That's what Yang Chenamson thought. And here is another very interesting image of a tiger. The picture is not clear here, but actually it was an, a Japanese military map of pacifying anti-Japanese guerrillas in Manchuria. Actually, that tiger is Kim Il-sung of North Korea, Kim Jong-un's grandfather. He was regarded as a tiger by the Japanese. And there is also a tiger division. Yong-woo showed it, a little bit about that. And there is a mark. There actually, the in a Vietnamese village, Hoi An, they built this kind of monument, which shows the massacres of Korean Korean troops, the Tiger Division. There is a mark, and the right one is the actual mark. And Im Hung-sun interviewed the victims of Korean rape of a Vietnamese woman, and I think it would be his next project. Okay. Let me start with the Cold War and the colonial legacy in South Korean religion and politics. If foreigners visiting Korea go around the Seoul streets by bus or taxi instead of subway at night, they'll be amazed by the constantly appearing church red cross. And over the past few months, two series of pro and con rallies have been held on the weekend in Seoul for the impeachment of former President Park Geun-hye. As is well known, many of the attendants at the anti-impeachment rallies, wearing taegukki and the stars and stripes, were Christians. And in the general election of last year, there were some advance of the newly organized Christian party. The Progressive Party did not gain many votes, but it was gained remarkable votes. Unlike other religions, Korean Christianity has successfully secured their room in the political arena. And let's begin with the from the late 19th century. At the end of the 19th century, some Western observers, typically Miss Louise Jordan Millen, she was a British actress who visited Korea. She published the book Quaint Korea. In that book, she said that Korea has no religion. Probably at that time, Buddhism was driven into the mountains, and the Confucian scholars did not talk about the afterlife. And in Korea, we did not have Almighty God like the Western people had. However, there is a long custom of gosa. I think it's a symbolic ritual of animism. When you have a gosa, you serve the rice cake every corner of the house, probably at least 30 or 40. You know, in Korea house, they are full of small spirits who is in charge of very small territory, their own territory. So I think we Koreans have a full of animistic mind. And also, Korea witnessed the emergence of Catholic believers before the arrival of European missionaries. Before European missionaries came, there emerged Korean believers. Furthermore, thousands of Koreans, Korea's early Catholic, became martyrs when the government persecuted the Western religion. In the 1860s, the Joseon dynasty faced with internal set of peasant rebellions and external set of Western powers. Koreans at the time were captured with bottomless anxiety. And since the 1860s, there was a kind of a religious explosion in Korea. There were emergence of new religions were continued. The first one was Donghak, or Eastern Learning. It was created by Choe Jae-woo to respond to the spread of Seohak, or Western Studies. Donghak led a large-scale peasants' rebellion in 1894. And there was also Jeongsangyo, created in 1902 by Kang Jeongsan, an explorer of Donghak. And Jeongsan Jeongsangyo is divided into many segments, but the total number of believers are about over 2 million currently. And there was also Bochongyo, created in 1921 by Cha Kyung-seok. And also there was Daejeongyo, created by Nachal. And also there is One Buddhism. These high religions also there is Muni, which has, I think, several million followers. And also a full gospel church led by David Cho or Cho Yong-gi. The full gospel church of Yeouido is the, simply the biggest church in the world. It has, the single church had about a half million believers. In a sense, Korean religions were politicized. The first typical case was Donghak. It led peasant uprising, and also Daejeongyo. It was an it played a very important role in Korea's independence movement. Koreans here should be familiar with the Cheongsan-ri battle. It was led by Daejeongyo people, and also the nationalist historiography was done by Daejeongyo. Now it is reduced, but during the 1920s, it was very powerful and influential. And the March 1st movement of 1919, the biggest nationalist movement of, in Korean history, was led and organized by religious leaders of Cheondo-kyo or Donghak or Protestant and Buddhist leaders. And one interesting case might be Bochongkyo's Cha Kyung-seok. Many people believe that Cha Kyung-seok would be the next emperor of Korea after it gained independence. Even though Korean provisional government was organized, the ordinary people believed that Korea would be emperor state. Bochongkyo asserted to have about 6 million followers. The Japanese police estimated its number to be over 2 million. While it estimated the total number of three major religions at the time, the Protestant Christianity, Buddhism, and Cheondo-kyo was only about 1 million. So Bochongkyo was very, very powerful. And even Cha Kyung-seok built his own new city, new town. But after he passed away, the Japanese dismantled this new town, and even they concreted his tomb to prevent him from revival. And the main building of the Bochongkyo was dismantled and moved, and it is now the main building of Joge Temple, the headquarters of the Korean Buddhism. These new religions respectively gathered at least hundreds of thousands of followers in short span of time. The early 20th century was on Age of Blooming of 100 Flowers with the creation of new domestic religions, with the import of new Western religions, and the revival of old religion Buddhism. An uneasy political situation and the fluctuating socio-economic environment brought about a religious explosion. And currently, the Deutsche Historische Museum has this exhibition, the Luther Effect. I went yesterday, and in this exhibition, the Korea is there has. It's a section about Korea, a special room for Korea, because the Korea gained the astonishing success story of the Korean Christianity. Unfortunately, this exhibition shows the bright aspect of the history of Korean Christianity. But in this catalog, the article about Korean article is very nice, and it also shows the dark side too. Korean Christianity has two cases of trauma behind the astounding growth of growth. The first one was occurred during the Japanese colonial period. The Japanese forced Korean Christian leaders and ordinary people to attend the Japanese Shinto shrines. Know that the Christians has to refuse idolatry, but however, they were forced to attend the Shinto shrine and have to bow to it. And this airplane is what the Korean Presbyterian Church collect money and bought and donated to Japanese army. To sincere Christians who had the belief of the refusal of idolatry, the forced attendance policy left a serious wound. At first, Korean Christians resisted the policy, but soon they accepted their status as Japanese imperial subject and attended the Shinto ceremony. Except for the very few who choose to go to jail, Korean Christian leaders suffered humiliation to visit shrines. With the outbreak of the Pacific War in December 1941, the United States became an enemy country to colonial Korea. Prominent Protestant leaders became Japanese collaborators, and they shouted the slogan of slaughtering Yankee beast and British ghost. They cooperated with Japan in the Pacific War. And high school girls were trained, they get military training. And my mother was of that age. I asked her, my mother, what did the Japanese do at that time? Then she said that if Yankee come to Korea, smash their head with this this weapons. And in 1945, Korea was divided. You know that the 30th parallel was like that simple, but you know it. The division line was marked in our heart, and we did not, we failed to erase it. The young boys and girls, if they survived the Korean War, they are now over, well over 70s. They are in their mid-70s. Nobody expected that the division of Korea would last so long. And the Japanese flag came down, but instead of a Korean flag, there were the stars and stripes. Japan's fall was a shock to the pro-Japanese, but the pro-Japanese who had a conversion from nationalists were very quick to prepare another adaptation to a new situation and transformed themselves into pro-Americans. Instead of punishing Japanese collaborators who had shouted slaughtering Yankee beasts, the U.S. embraced them surprisingly. That to govern a strange country, the U.S. needed a junior partner. But during the colonial period, the OSS had a secret operation with Korean Provisional Government and the leader was Kim Gu. They joined hands with each other. But after the liberation, the U.S. Did not choose Kim Gu as their junior partner because Kim Gu was a sincere nationalist who would pursue Korean interest to the end. The United States wants somebody who would serve for the American interest. So they chose the Japanese collaborators. There was also one Korean Protestant leader, Mr. Chan Pil-sun. He, during the late phase of the colonial period, he changed his name, Pyeonggang Miju. It means that conquer and pacify the American continent. But this kind of people became the partner, junior partner of American occupation, and this kind of people became the leader of Korean Christianity. He is a leftist activist and scholar. The Park Chi-woo, he became a leader of Korean guerrilla during the Korean War period. But at the time, he said that American people were more generous than Buddha because they embraced the pro-Japanese collaborators. Among pro-Japanese collaborators, who could speak English adopted American name, John or Mary. And they were privileged, they were privileged by the American military government. And for example, think about the, I'll show you some leading Korean churches. But it's Hangyeongjik Yongnak Church, the largest Presbyterian church in the world. But actually, it was located at the site of a Japanese Buddhist temple. And it is Haebang Church, the headquarters of the refugees from the North Korea. But it was built on the Japanese Shinto at Shinto Shrine. And it was on the Gyeongdong Church, one of very prominent church, and it was a kind of center of the democratization movement by Christian democratic movement in the 1970s. But it was built on the site of the Japanese Tenri Temple. And also there is Hanshin University, the Korean Christian College, leading Korean Christian College. But it was built on the site of the Tenri Temple. And there is Sung-ui Girls School. It was built on the another Shinto shrine. Like in this way, many South Korean churches could take over the Japanese property after Korea was liberated. And in North Korea, there came Soviet Union, and Kim Il-sung became the head of the new government. Actually, Kim Il-sung had a Christian family background. His maternal grandfather was one of the oldest Christian leader in Korea. And Kim Il-sung's father, Kim Hyung-jik, graduated Seungsil School. He had a very strong family background, Christian background, and at first he was not he did not suppress the Christianity, and he wanted cooperation with Christians, but Christians refused, and then and there were some persecutions, of course. So the North Korean Christian leaders fled to South. Many ministers and leading Christians came down to South to escape the persecution of communists. But there came another trauma to become the able shepherd who fled the flock and ran away. The Old Testament said, "Oh, my worthless shepherd, who deserts the flocks. May the sword strike his arm and his right eye. Let his arm be completely withered, his right eye utterly blinded." So the South Korean Christian leaders who fled from North Korea were not free from this kind of trauma. And this newspaper article shows that the hegemony of current Korean Protestant was owned and built by those who came from North Korea. And Lee Seung-man, the first president of South Korea, wanted to create a Christian state. He was the first PhD who get first U.S. First PhD who got his degree from the United States. And then there occurred the Christianization of the state under Lee Seung-man. The government started a campaign of break all the superstitions and expel shamans. It was not just began under Park Chung-hee. Actually, the Japanese also did that. And also, during the 1920s, Korean nationalists, nationalists were modernizers. And they also shouted, break all the superstitions. But here, under Lee Seung-man, he has some sort of Christian meaning too. And at that time, almost half of the cabinet members were appointed with Christians. You know, the whole Korean Christian population was less than 3% at that time. But at the cabinet, well over 40% of the cabinet members were Christians. And the state rituals were Christianized. And Lee Seung-man regime officially appointed pastors in the military and prison. And there is another very uneasy fact. I'm very uncomfortable with this fact, but actually it is a truth that we cannot avoid. Almost all the figures who played an important role in the massacres during the Korean War period were Christians. We believe that at least 500,000 people got massacred, but almost all the members were Christians. And the South Korean and UN forces advanced to North Korea. In the history of the Cold War, the Korean War had a special place. Before the collapse of the Eastern European communist regimes in 1989, the UN occupation of North Korea was the only example that the territory of a communist regime fell under the control of the Western power. All wars were terrible, indeed. Yet North Koreans' memory of the UN occupation was extremely terrible. There was a so-called Sinchan Massacre. Unlike North Korean propaganda that blames the US wolves as the main slaughterers who committed widespread civilian massacres during the occupation, it was returned North Korean youth, especially young Christians with anti-communist sense, who actually committed atrocities. Well-known writer Hwang Seo-kyung wrote about a novel about Sinchan Massacre. Its title was Sonnim, in English as the guest. Even though ordinary Koreans were killed, but main actors were Christians and communists. They were guests. They were strangers to long history of Korea. And North Korean, North Korean youth, especially young Christians with anti-communist stance, organized the so-called Northwest Youth Association, or 서북청년단. It was a very, very notorious terrorist organization. The Korean War was a real tragedy for the older people, but however, it was a decisive moment for Korean Christianity to expand. The Christianity was a magic door for Koreans to build one's connection with the United States. Many houseboys, big brother and younger brother. And it was a mad time of massacres. When you were once appointed out as a red, you might lose your life. Then, if a pastor come and, this lady belongs to our church. She is a good believer of Jesus. I guarantee. Then you can save your lives. So to be a Christian was a very, very important thing in this kind of, bad hours. And also there were U.S. relief. This U.S. Relief were usually distributed through the church. Think about these young people. These are now in their 70s, and they are the backbones of the pro-United States and pro-Pakgunhae and ultra-right-wing atmosphere in Korea. And also, it's in the, I think these young boys were in the church. And when, for women, if you go to church, you don't have to have this ancestor worship. You don't have to prepare all this food. Just pray. So, in 1950, the number of Korean Christians, Christian believers in Korea were, was just a half million. It exceeded 8 million in 1991. This means that the number of Korean Christians had doubled every 10 years during the Cold War period. Korean Christianity expanded rapidly to unprecedented levels in the world. However, the expansion of Korean Christianity was centered on megachurches. In 1993, 23 out of the 50 largest churches in the world are in Korea. I think this phenomenon is much more intensified. And this is the Sunbogum Church, and it simply had a half well over half a million people. And his younger brother also had a huge church. I think it also had at least 300 or 400 followers. Korean Christianity did not expand itself by eliminating shamanism in the Korean society. Instead, the Korean Christianity built a solid conjunction with shamanism and expanded its power by providing a substitute of shamanistic psychological healing for the masses, for the, we can call it prosperity gospel. Just pray for money, pray for new car, pray for property. Yeah. And also that some pastors are like shamans. And Korean Christians went to fortune tellers very much. And sometimes the church inactively tolerate or actively embrace the shamanistic element of believers. But sometimes shamans also vigorously borrowed Christian costumes. Choi Tae-min, the Choi Soon-sil's father, Choi Soon-sil was the protagonist of the recent scandal, a friend of Park Geun-hye. Choi Tae-min be the typical case of the shaman who changed his who wore Christian costume. He created his own Yeongsaenggyo, but only after 3 months he stood in front of the public as a Protestant pastor. Probably you know the WikiLeaks and. It also had the numerous information about Korean situation. And in WikiLeaks, in a telegram, U.S. ambassador to Korea reported to Washington. It said that Choi Tae-min had complete control over Park's body and soul. And they held an prayer rallies, and he also organized the Crusade of National Salvation that aimed to conduct military training to 50 Christian ministers. So Park Geun-hye went to that training, and it is the Choi Tae-min. And he also one interesting fact is that it was Park Jung-hee, not Choi Tae-min, who first used the term crusade in the Cold War. When he sent his troops to Vietnam, he called it Crusade of Liberty. But when the Korean troops returned to Korea, he wanted them to become Crusaders of National Salvation. So Choi Tae-min borrowed that word, and he organized the Crusade of the Cold War. And in the 1970s, Billy Graham visited Korea, and he held this large-scale meeting. And this is the Sunbogum Church, and this is the Korean National Assembly. But it was the time of this kind of large-scale mobilization. You know, that they held an anti-communist rally in 1975. I'm somewhere around here. As a high school student, I was mobilized too. You know, that there were a lot of this kind of large-scale rallies. And then in North Korea, recent one, and in the third Lahi. My colleague Kwon Jin-gan said, when Choi Tae-min remained as a shaman or the master of a small-scale religion, he did not rely on the Cold War ideology or anti-communism. It is noteworthy that only after he pretended as a Christian pastor, he began to produce the anti-communist discourse. And let's move to current period. With the end of the Cold War, explosive growth of the Korean Christianity slowed considerably. Nonetheless, Protestant churches are still the main source of the conservative camps. This is somewhat bizarre meeting when U.S. ambassador to Korea was attacked and he was wounded. Then the South Korean Protestant churches gathered and to apologize to him, they held this kind of rallies. And the recent political scandals in Korea, there were candlelight protests and the impeachment and impeachment of former President Park Geun-hye clearly showed that there are very backward element and potentially very advanced element in the 20th century of Korean society. So this ambivalent existence of backwardness and advancement, advanced element. And when Park Geun-hye was elected, nobody knew that Park had been so terribly dominated by the superstitious, fatalistic thinking system of Choi Tae-min and Choi Soon-sil. There's a lot of evidence about Park Geun-hye's shamanistic attitude. So kind of shamanistic regime. And she and some pictures were revealed. You know that she attended a shamanistic ritual to commemorate her parents, Park Jang-hee and Yoo Kyung-soo. The case of Park Geun-hye would be the worst example. But unfortunately, the conservative elites are sharing a lot with Park Geun-hye and Choi Soon-sil, pro-Japanese origins and pro-American attitude. Actually, Choi Tae-min was a Japanese policeman during the colonial period. Park Jang-hee was a puppet Manchukuo officer. And Cold War style ultra-right-wing anti-communism, Christianity in harmony with shamanism and the privileged consciousness and so on. South Korea always envied American democracy, but when Park Geun-hye stepped down, the SNS in Trump's US was overflowing with envy of Korea. If they can do it, we can do it. And Park Chan-kyung's Shin Do-an, actually Shin Do-an is in Mountain Kaegyung. It's a remote area. It's far from Seoul. But I think Shin Do-an is not in a remote area. Shin Do-an is in Seoul too. Korean religions, especially Protestantism, have failed to overcome shamanistic playing over personal fortune and wealth. In Korea, the mega church is another Shin Do-an, which was westernized only in its appearance with Christian costumes. The Shin Do-an that Park Chan-kyung showed is now located to remote countryside far from Seoul. Whether the Korean Christianity could overcome the Cold War shamanism and find its right place as a modern religion has a pivotal importance for Korean conservatism to regain health and regenerate the entire Korean society. I think I have some more minutes. Okay, is it right? Yeah, so five? Okay. And then I'd like to add some aspect that we are talking about the colonial legacy. And then let me show what is the colonial legacy in South Korea. For example, I'd like to show you the Japanese military comfort women cases. I think you are familiar with the cases, but unfortunately, during the Korean War period, the South Korean Army operated the military comfort women system during the Korean War period. Actually, it is the official history, official war history on the home front, officially published in 1956, 11 years after the World War II ended. Now the Japanese are trying very hard that, oh no. Of course, there were Japanese comfort women, but it was not run by government. Japanese government has nothing to do with it. It was done by military, the civilian businessman. So it has nothing to do with the army. That's what the logic of Japanese right wings. But however, in South Korea, the army headquarters published it in their book, and they said that it was a case of 1952. It shows four comfort women stations. Actually, there were a lot more, but it shows statistics of four. And it says that there were 89 comfort women. But in a year, they served over 200,000 soldiers. Now that, at that time, it was the size of a Korean army at that time. So less than 100 comfort women served this amount of soldiers. Of course, the Japanese military comfort women system was much more systematic and much larger in scale. But however, it is true that South Korean army also run this kind of a system too. It says that, I think it is the true colonial legacy. In Korea, we did not expel the pro-Japanese collaborators. In Japan, the military leaders were kicked out by the US government. But in South Korea, US government embraced former Japanese officers, and they became the high commanders of the South Korean army. And they thought that, well, to encourage our soldiers, the women's are needed, women's body is needed. Women's body were needed, and we should supply comfort and clear and safe sex to our soldiers. That's what they're thinking. I think it's a pure colonial legacy. Think about that. Park Chung-hee was educated by Japanese military, and all other South Korean military commanders were educated by the Japanese imperialist system. We did not liquidate this kind of way of thinking. And it is the real colonial legacy. And during the Vietnam War period, South Korean government did not bring the comfort women issue to the table in the normalization treaty negotiation with Japan. Instead, it discussed sending comfort women to Vietnam with its troops. I think it is the true legacy of Japanese imperialism in post-colonial Korea. Another thing is the so-called purification campaign of the U.S. military base. There is a very good book by Catherine Moon, Sex Among Allies. This is a signature of Park Chung-hee. It says that to launch the cleanup campaign to provide the U.S. GIs with safe and more comfortable sex service by eliminating widespread venereal disease in the camp towns. So it has this kind of examination of venereal disease system. It is the very nature of the state law in the comfort woman system. So the same kind of examination of venereal disease was done in 1970s in South Korea. I think this kind of things are the colonial legacy. And also, we talked about Manchukuo yesterday. It is called Gwitae. Gwi means ghost, Tae means pregnant. So pregnant is by the ghost. It means that it should not be born. It is a symbolic metaphor to Manchukuo. Manchukuo should not be born. But in 2012, December of 2012, Abe won the election in Japan, and 3 days later, Bakune was elected. It was mentioned yesterday and today, Abe Shinzo was the grandson of Kishin Nobusuke, and Bakune was daughter of Park Jong-hee. And look at North Korea. Kim Jong-un is grandson of Kim Il-sung, who fought at Manchukuo as an anti-Japanese guerrilla. So North and South Korea and Japan, they became second and third generation of Manchukuo period. And look at China. The Xi Jinping is son of eight great old revolutionaries. Xi Jinping's father was Xi Jinping, the vice premier, and he became the. Xi Jinping was a typical case of the prince group in Chinese history. Then, look at East Asia. East Asia was a very dynamic area during the late 20th centuries. But suddenly in 2010s, then second or third generation politicians are prevailing. But is it ASEAN cases? I don't think so. Think about the France after the French Revolution. You know that in guillotine they executed the kings. Even this, they had this kind of a revolution. Napoleon became an emperor, and also later his nephew Napoleon III became an emperor too. France also underwent this kind of political ordeal. So during that period, so the film Les Misérables came. And to achieve this today's democracy, the French lost a lot of people. It was a picture of a Paris Commune, several thousand got killed. In South Korea, we have currently achieved peaceful impeachment. But I don't know what would be the real result of that impeachment. The situation is still flowing, and the history is under construction. So we have a long way to go now. Thank you very much for your attention.